the things that liquids do is vaporize. So we're going to talk about that process, the process of vaporization, in this lesson. So what is it? And eventually we'll lead into our next lesson, which has to do with vapor pressure. Vaporization is when molecules on the surface, okay, have enough kinetic energy to break free of that surface and get into the gas phase. Those molecules, that process, when it goes from the liquid state to the gas phase, is vaporization. We use interchangeably the word evaporation associated with vaporization. So those molecules can break free and get into the vapor phase. Now, the opposite could be true. If I were to put a lid on this, some of the molecules could condense down and get back into the liquid phase, and that would be condensation. Okay, so vaporization and condensation, evaporation, condensation are opposite processes. But it's important to know that, okay, those molecules are attracted to the other molecules, and that's why they're in liquid state. So they're down inside your container, moving about and attracted to each other. But if they absorb enough energy from the surroundings to where they can break that attraction, then they will go free. And it's only the molecules on the surface that can do that, because if a molecule is way down low and it has enough energy to break free, okay, it can't break free. It's being bumped around constantly by other molecules and exchanging energy. So the chance that that molecule way down there could get all the way to the surface and maintain all of its energy to break free is very unlikely. So it's got to get to the surface before it can evaporate. Now, there is a process called boiling, and we'll learn about boiling later, that molecules down at the bottom can get enough energy and they can rise to the top as a big bubble. But we'll talk about that in that process much later. Okay, so there's several factors that affect the rate of evaporation, okay? So some things, I could spill a little water on a counter and be lazy and not clean it up. Eventually, I could come back and that water would be gone. I could spill a little bit of rubbing alcohol on a counter and not wipe it up and come back and it'd be gone. But the rate of how it evaporates could be different. I might spill a little bit of water here in the room and spill a little bit on a sidewalk outside on a hot day and spill exact same amount of water in both places, and they're going to evaporate at different rates. So there's certain things that affect how fast things will get into the gas phase. So temperature's one. Compare inside versus out on a hot summer day. Surface area is another one. If I were to spill a little or have a little water open in a small net container, or I would take the same amount of water and pour it all out on the counter, the surface area is going to affect it. And also, if I have two different things, one's alcohol, rubbing alcohol, and the other one is water, they have different attractions between the molecules, and that's going to affect. So we're going to look at each one of these three things in a little bit more detail. Okay, so here's your first question. What effect would you expect with an increase in temperature? And this is on the rate of intermolecular attraction, rate of evaporation, okay? What would you expect? Knowing this, as the temperature goes up, the kinetic energy of the molecules goes up. That is a fact, okay? As molecules get heated up, the temperature rises, stop and choose one. Okay, hopefully, based upon lots of reasoning here, you said that increased temperature will increase the rate. Now let's look at this diagram. We've seen this diagram when we were dealing with gases. The same distribution is true for liquids. So blue is the lower temperature. Let's say that this is the amount of energy right here. This amount of kinetic energy is what is required in order to, if you were a surface molecule, in order to break free and get into the gas phase. So all surface molecules that have enough energy could escape, and that's this many. All right? But as we raise the temperature to a higher temperature, that same kinetic energy is what's needed, but you have a whole lot more of them that have that energy. And so you're going to have, typically, just raising the temperature by 10 degrees, you're going to have twice as many molecules that have enough energy. You're going to double the rate of that evaporation by increasing the temperature. So it's simply because you've got more molecules, and always increasing the temperature will increase the rate of evaporation. Oops, went the wrong direction. Let's go to the next one. What effect will increased surface area have on the rate of evaporation? Now let's think about this before you answer. If I were to take 5 milliliters and it's in a test tube, okay, so I have 5 milliliters in a test tube and it has this little small surface area, or if I were to take those 5 milliliters and pour them out onto a countertop here, okay, so I have my countertop and I poured those out on my countertop, it's only the surface molecules that can evaporate. I told you that. So what effect will increased surface area have? Okay, so certainly if it's the molecules that are on the surface that can evaporate, if you've got a whole lot more surface molecules, you have a lot more opportunity for evaporation. Keep going the wrong direction. Okay, last one. Intermolecular force. Let's remember what that means. This is the attractive force in between molecules. We have to somehow break that force, that attractive force, if we want a molecule to get up into the gas phase or the vapor phase. Okay? We have to break that attraction, so choose one of those. Now, this is a one that's kind of opposite of what our other trends are. Here, if you strengthen the intermolecular force, if they are more strongly held together, it will decrease the rate of evaporation. You won't have as many molecules that have enough energy to break free of that attractive force. This takes us to the energetics, okay? There's actually measurable energy. I keep talking about breaking this attraction between these things. There's measurable energy required to break them apart and get them into the gas phase. This energy is called the energetics of vaporization. We call it heat of vaporization sometimes. If you look at my little equation there, I have 1 mole of a gas. I'm sorry, I started with 1 mole of a liquid and I'm converting it to 1 mole of a gas. And it's going to take a certain amount of energy to do that. So let's draw a mole of something, all right? So I've got a liquid, okay, let's make it a beaker. And we've got these little molecules in here in the liquid phase. We know that they're bouncing around each other and they're really touching each other. And we're going to put a heat source. Ah, it's upside down flame. Let's put a heat source underneath it, okay? We're going to add and warm up this thing, and these guys are going to evaporate. They're going to be able to go into the gas phase. The only way they can do that is to break those attractions. Let's say I have a whole mole of them, 1 mole. And I want to convert this whole mole of a liquid to a whole mole of a gas. To do that, I have to break all of these attractions. Every one of them is going to have to be broken. And there's an amount of energy associated with that that we give the symbol delta H of vaporization. You'll hear it called delta H vap. Heat of vaporization is the other way you will hear it referred to. So this is going to be a direct measure of the strength of those intermolecular forces. We can compare intermolecular forces and say this is stronger than that, but this is a mathematical, calculatable, measurable energy that tells us how strongly they're connected together. So the more strongly they're held together, the more energy it's going to take to pull them apart. Delta H of vaporization will do that. Okay? Now how is the relationship? Let's think about that. The stronger the force, the higher this is going to be. So we've made comparisons. We know how to compare this guy to this guy. We can say that water has got stronger intermolecular forces because of hydrogen bonding. Then let's pick another substance. Let's say methane has weaker intermolecular forces. So we'll compare H2O to CH4. This is nonpolar. This is superpolar. This is our hydrogen bonding. This is going to have stronger intermolecular forces. This is going to have weaker intermolecular forces. Therefore, we can easily say this is going to have a stronger heat of vaporization, a bigger, greater magnitude energy than this one is going to have. Now, there'll be times that you'll need a value for this. I couldn't find one in our textbook yet. Maybe there is one, but certainly a quick web search of heat of vaporizations, tables of heat of vaporizations, and you'll be able to look up values for all sorts of substances. Okay, so that is vaporization. That's the process of vaporization. We can compare the rate of vaporization based upon temperature, surface area, and strength of intermolecular forces. And we can associate an energy with that process. How much energy does it take to do it?